Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and Apple has updated their iPad lineup this year again, and currently there are essentially four different models, so I wanted to help you decide which one would be best for you, and before we get started, this video is sponsored by Paperlike. Now there are five things that I think most iPad buyers are considering: size and display, price, speed, accessories, and the cameras. Now currently we have four different iPads in front of us for the different offerings of Apple's latest models. On the far left, we have the ninth generation iPad. This is essentially the traditional iPad. It has top borders on the top and bottom. They're very big bezels, and we have a home button. We also have an aluminum frame, or aluminium depending on where you live, and it's sort of curved around the outside edges and is the only one that lies flat on a table, regardless of it having a camera. The others have a camera bump. So we have that, and it also uses Lightning. All of the rest use USB-C. So let's look at the next one, which is the sixth generation iPad mini. This is the newer squared off design, and this allows for pencil attachment to it, has that camera bump, like I said, and I think has a really nice feel, but maybe a little bit more fragile based on who you would ask. If you go to bend one or sit on one, you have a higher likelihood of bending this one than you would with the traditional design. However, I haven't run into that myself. Then we have the fifth generation iPad Air. Again, it's essentially the same as the 11-inch iPad Pro. So this is the newer one for this year, and it's got sort of the same squared off edge. And then finally, we have the iPad Pro 12.9-inch. So that's Apple's top of the line with the top of the line display. So when it comes to the displays, we have the standard display. This is a 10.2-inch 2160 by 1620 with 264 pixels per inch and goes up to 500 nits of brightness. It is not a laminated display, which means that the glass is not attached to the LCD underneath. And it's also very reflective because they don't have a reflective or an anti-reflective coating on it. So you can see it is an oleophobic coating, meaning it doesn't show as many fingerprints, but it's very reflective. But it does help with repairability if you wanted to just easily remove the glass and then replace that if something happened to it. The iPad mini has an 8.3-inch display, 2,266 by 1,488 with 326 pixels per inch and goes up to 500 nits of brightness. Then we have the iPad Air 10.9-inch with 2,360 by 1,640 pixels up to 264 pixels per inch, again going up to 500 nits of brightness. Then the iPad Pro is a very different display. This is a 12.9-inch display, 2,732 by 2,048 with 264 pixels per inch, but goes up to 1,600 nits of brightness when watching HDR content. It can go up to 1,000 nits of brightness with just regular use. So if I was to turn this all the way up, it will just almost look white on your display because it's so bright that the camera just picks it up as overly bright. And so this is incredibly bright, but with the Mini, the Air, and the Pro, we all have laminated displays and anti-reflective coatings. With the Pro, we also have ProMotion, which is super smooth. So while the other displays are nice and fast, they go up to 60 hertz. With the iPad Pro, we have 120 hertz. So you have to see this in person to appreciate it, but just scrolling, going through different content, playing games is very, very smooth on the display. Now, like I said, there's reflectivity on all of these. In fact, you can see that the iPad, the traditional iPad, has the most reflective screen. However, if you'd like to protect your display but keep the device thin and light, but also cut down even more on reflectivity, that's where today's sponsor comes in, Paperlike. Paperlike is a screen protector that drastically reduces glare and fingerprints. I have it installed on my iPad Pro, and you can see that here. But unlike many screen protectors, it also makes the display feel like paper when using the Apple Pencil. So if I go into notes and maybe write Zolotech, it actually feels and sounds like paper as well. So take a listen to this. Paperlike can also give you more control when you're using the Apple Pencil, as it adds the right amount of grip and sort of resistance to the tip of the Apple Pencil. But it's friendly to the tip of the Apple Pencil, as you can see from this Apple Pencil that my daughter uses on a Paperlike screen protector and has been for over 6 months almost every day, so it's held up really well. Paperlike includes two Paperlike covers and application tools in each package, and has a 100% guarantee for the first 100 days. They also offer pencil grip grip sets, as well as cleaning accessories as well. Be sure to check them out in the description below. Now, Apple makes some really great displays, but the iPad Pro stands out when it comes to HDR video. The iPad Air and Mini are also capable of HDR, but the Pro is 3 times as bright and has different dimming zones that can keep the black areas very dark and then the bright areas very vibrant without lighting the entire display. You can see if we go into YouTube, we have the capability of HDR even on the Mini here. So if we go to the Mini, select our quality, this is one of my YouTube videos in HDR, you'll see that we have up to 2160p or 4K HDR. However, we do not have HDR capabilities on the standard iPad. So if we go into YouTube to the same video, you'll see we have up to 2160p, but just not in HDR. So you won't be able to watch the HDR content on YouTube if you go with the standard version. Now, all of them have pretty decent speakers, but again, the Pro stands above the rest of them, and it should for the price, but we have 4 speakers. We have 2 on each side when you're holding it in landscape, so a top and a bottom. You'll see here a top and bottom, and they're really great sounding. They have good spatial audio, and it's definitely the best experience here when it comes to audio. It's really hard to hear that, though, just from the microphone I'm using for this video. With the iPad Air and iPad Mini, you have 2 speakers, but you still have 4 openings. So one of them is a speaker, and then the other is sort of a resonance chamber to actually give it a bigger sound overall. So you have the same sort of 4 speaker grills. The same is true on the iPad Mini. So the same 4 grills there, same layout as you can see. So no difference there. However, on the standard iPad, you have 2 stereo speakers that are on the bottom of the device, on either side of the Lightning port. So you have only 2 speakers, but at the top you have one thing the others don't have, and that's a stereo jack or a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack. So you have that option to use headphones if you want to do that, and that may be a big advantage for you. So that's something that the regular iPad, even though it's the least expensive, still has that the others don't. So you have to use wireless headphones or an adapter with USB-C to 3.5 millimeters to use headphones that are wired with the iPad, other than the standard one. Now, price, of course, is going to be one of the biggest considerations between any of these. We start at $329 and go all the way up to $2,199 with the iPad Pro. There is a huge variance between all of the iPads. So from the Mini, $500 or $499 it starts at, the Air starts at $599, the 11-inch iPad Pro starts at $799, and the 12.9-inch iPad Pro starts at $1,099. Now, we have a big difference in storage options as well. The standard iPad, iPad Mini, and iPad Air all have options for 64 gigabytes or 256 gigabytes of storage, where the iPad Pro models have a bunch of different options, or 5 options, 128 gigabytes, 256, 512, 1 terabyte or 2 terabyte storage options. And you also can go up to 16 gigs of RAM. So you have a huge amount of options here, but you don't really see too much of a difference with that RAM. Now, you can buy these refurbished typically from Apple and get a bit of a discount with the same warranty. So there are opportunities for cheaper versions. Also, oftentimes on places such as Amazon, you'll find them discounted and they're sold directly by Apple. So there are a lot of options as far as getting these less expensive than the retail price that Apple has them advertised at. When it comes to the overall speed of the iPads, this might be a big consideration, but if you're using them for standard things, you may not notice a difference, and I'll show you that in a moment. But with the standard iPad, we have the A13 Bionic, the Mini A15 Bionic, and the Air and Pro both have Apple's M1 chip in it. So both of them are pretty similar as far as that goes, with up to 16 gigabytes of RAM in the iPads Pro. So if you get an iPad Pro, you can go up to the 2 terabyte or 16 gig option. Now, I wanted to show you just opening different things to show you if there's any difference, because for most tasks, you're really not going to notice a whole lot of things, but in other things you may. Now, if we open a simple app and we're just doing regular tasks on our iPad, you'll see if we open Safari, it opens pretty quickly. Basically the same on all of them, nice and fast when we open them up. If we close all of these out and maybe go into the App Store, you'll see a similar experience. So if we go into the App Store on all of them, as I open them, you may have to wait half a second and then everything just shows up. So you really won't notice a difference with just day-to-day tasks. And you can also do heavy tasks even on the standard iPad with the A13 Bionic. you can maybe export a 4K video. So let me show you that. Now let's bring in my iPhone as a stopwatch here, and let's see if we can export all of these 4K videos recorded at the same time. They're HEVC videos as well, recorded from an iPhone. So let's see if we can let go at the same time, and let's try this now and see what happens. We'll hit start on the stopwatch and see how long it takes to export. Now they finished in a time that seems reasonable for all of them, about a minute and 7 seconds to export a 4K video. So that's pretty impressive by itself. And overall, the M1s finish faster, and then the iPad mini, and then the regular iPad. But it's not a huge jump between all of them. One area where you would see a difference between these has to do with the neural engine. The neural engine is faster on the M1. It can process more in the background when it comes to things like augmented reality, or maybe you're scanning a room with the LiDAR sensor on the back of the iPad Pro. So we have a LiDAR sensor along with our cameras, and that LiDAR sensor can actually throw out different measurements and understand what the measurement of maybe a room is, and then plot that in 3D. If you want to use intensive apps that do things like that or use augmented reality, well, this would be the iPad for you. But if you don't care about that, well, you may be able to accomplish your tasks very easily with the regular iPad. So it really depends on what you plan to use them for. When it comes to the cameras, we have the same 12 megapixel camera on all of them. They're pretty much the same camera, with the exception of the Pro, where we have a true depth sensor. Because we have Face ID on the Pro, it allows us to use the true depth sensor for things such as Memoji. So if we go into Messages, within Messages we have things like Memoji, where it actually measures your face in real time, where it's angled, the depth of it, and everything else. So you can see that here, and you could switch between whatever you'd like in real time, and it's using that true depth camera. So you have that, but we also have center stage on all of them. Now all iPads have center stage. Center stage allows you to use the iPad maybe on a conference call or in FaceTime or something like that, and it will track you around the room. So if we go into FaceTime, now in FaceTime or different conferencing apps, you have the ability to use center stage. This is sort of like having a cameraman built into your iPad. If I move over here, it will follow me over here. The same is true no matter where I move, as long as I'm within the camera's range. It also will sort of zoom out if you have multiple people. And then because of the neural engine on all of these, you can blur the background, and it just has some nice effects as well. So this is something you can do on all these iPads, from the least expensive to the most expensive this year. Now the rear cameras are different on all of them, a little bit different on all of them. You'll see that they do stick out on the back of the iPad Air, and let me just turn these over so you can see. So on the standard iPad, we have an 8 megapixel camera, just a singular camera in the back. On the iPad mini and iPad Air, we have 12 megapixel cameras, and then on the iPad Pro, we have a 12 megapixel wide and a 10 megapixel ultra wide camera, along with that LiDAR sensor. So we have additional capabilities with the iPad, but I wouldn't recommend anyone just buy the iPad for the rear camera, as you probably have a phone that is a little more capable with different features. So you have those options if you need to use it, maybe to storyboard something, use it for a conference call, or just snap a picture quickly, you'll have that ability. But they're not as good as what's on your iPhone typically. Your latest iPhone will have a better camera normally. Now you do have cellular options on all of the iPads. Even with the standard iPad, for $130 more, you can have 4G connectivity. However, the iPad mini, Air, and Pro all offer 5G. But on the Pro, it's $200 extra, where on the iPad mini and Air, it's $150 extra. So there's a bit of a difference there, depending on what you want for cellular. Now, of course, accessories are one of the things that you really probably are going to want to buy with your iPad, such as this Apple Pencil. This is the first generation Apple Pencil that's compatible with only the standard iPad. So you have the first generation and the second generation Apple Pencil, but the second generation works with the Mini, Air, and Pro, but does not work back with the standard iPad. So you have to pick which one works for you. So if you have a regular Apple Pencil laying around, you can just use this, place the Lightning connector into the bottom of the iPad, it will sync, and then you can use it with your iPad. But on the other iPads, they attach magnetically, and then you can just use them simply by attaching them to the side. They pair up, you can use the Apple Pencil, it recognizes it, and then you can use it with your device if you want to do that. So very simple and straightforward, and that's really all there is to it. So it works really well. The second generation Apple Pencil is a must have if you're going to edit video or maybe just draw using Procreate or some other application, or maybe you just want to use it to take notes or just scroll through things. It makes it as more of a refined pointing device, such as a mouse. Now, of course, you can use a keyboard or mouse with any one of these, but with the Mini, the Air, and the Pro, you have some different options. One of my favorite accessories is the Magic Keyboard, and to me, that's a must-have if you want to use this as sort of a computer replacement. So the Magic Keyboard is very expensive at about $350 for the largest iPad, but it offers a trackpad, a backlit keyboard, and then allows the iPad to hover on it. I would highly recommend this if you plan to use this as a desktop replacement. You also have the option to charge on the side. You have various covers as well for this. So if you don't need a keyboard, of course, you can use just the standard cover, or you could get a third-party cover as well. So there's a ton of different accessories for this. Now, all of the iPads have the same battery life. Apple claims up to 10 hours for all of them. So if you're considering an iPad based on battery, they're the same for all of them. Just pick whichever iPad you want and they'll get the same. Also, charging is very similar. So they all have fast charging, you have Lightning on the standard iPad and USB-C on the others. And so hopefully that helped you decide which iPad would be best for you, whether it's based on speed, what the display is like, and more. So all of them are quite good. Personally, I like the iPad Pro because it's sort of a desktop replacement. When I'm not editing videos, this is what I use most of the time, so I like the larger display. However, most people will probably want to go with the Air as it offers more features than the standard iPad, but is also a little bit larger size than the others. So we have a nicer display, more modern with Touch ID, and a laminated display, less reflective and more. So I would recommend the Air to a lot of people, or the Mini if you just want a smaller one. But with the Air, you get the latest processor, of course, the same as the iPad Pro. With the standard iPad, it's definitely something I can recommend if you don't care about any of that. So if you just want a standard iPad to view content, maybe edit a video even on it, you could do that. But all of these are quite good. But for me personally, I typically tell people to go with the Air or the Pro. But again, your budget really determines what you want to go with, and you could also get them refurbished or even used later on. Now, later this year, we do expect some new iPad Pro launches to come out with maybe just a 12.9 with some differences, but we'll see a new iPad typically every year to year and a half or so. So either way, these will be getting updated from time to time, and usually Apple supports them for at least 5 years. So iPadOS 15 is out now. You could see them supported all the way up to iPadOS 20. So no worries there, maybe even past that, 21 or 22. They'll be supported for many years to come. So I'd love to hear which one would work best for you in the comments below, or what iPad you're using. I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. Of course, be sure to check out Paperlike if you're looking for a screen protector or just want to give a little bit different matte texture to your iPad or provide a better writing surface. I think most people that use this really, really like it. Let me know if you're picking one up in the comments below, and again, be sure to check them out in the description. If you'd like to get your hands on this iPad wallpaper that I have here, I'll link it in the description below. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.